Good to see you.
Hello, hello.
Congrats on qualifying.
Thank
I know you're glad to have
much.
That done.
Yes,
good
absolutely.
To see you guys.
So have you met Nydia Tisdale and Garland
family? Hi.
Yet?
No, Garland.
Yes, hi, Tochie. Nice
good to see you, Garland.
Thanks,
come on
thanks
in.
For doing this.
Yeah. Oh, you're more than welcome.
Garland actually just introduced me to some of his rich friends. That's what
we're and so. Well, good.
Hey, Catherine, I'm over glad. It's nice to see you,
yeah.
too.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for
tuning in.
Oh, our pleasure.
Right,
I love the sign
yeah.
they put out.
I think that's
yeah,
super.
I'll
just
see it.
Yeah,
I'm
trying to raise money.
Oh, I think it's wonderful.
Well, good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for coming out, and thank you so much to Tochie and Robert for hosting us at your beautiful home. I don't think I've gotten to be out and see the pool yet, so this is absolutely fabulous over here in beautiful Sandy Springs. So wonderful to have our first meet and greet here. For those of you that I have not met yet, Catherine Bernard, I am running for state representative for House District 80. House District 80 covers most of Brookhaven, a big chunk of Sandy Springs, where we are right now, and then a little bit of Chamblee. So as we were talking about with some folks earlier tonight, it's a really interesting and dynamic area. You know, it's not an area that has to worry about people leaving. You know, our question is how we deal with growth, because there's so many people who want to come and live in beautiful House District 80 that the three cities that make up the district have some challenges in how to plan and manage that smart growth. So I think as the House representative, you've got a pretty big role to play in navigating the issues with these three cities. I think I'm the best choice for this for three reasons. I've got the three E's, which are experience, ethics, and effectiveness. So first of all, I'll let you know a little bit about my experience. I am a criminal defense lawyer. Yes, for a while I was afraid of that term. There was a little bit of stigma, but someone was reminding me today about John Adams being a criminal defense lawyer and not such a bad thing. But what it's done is given me an excellent perspective on the way our laws are actually being interpreted in courtrooms around the state. I've practiced in front of judges all over the state, in the metro area, up north, down south. It really has allowed me to see the way our laws are working, or in some cases, not working. I've had judges absolutely tell me, "I'm sorry, we don't know what to do with this law. The legislators just gave it to us." And this experience has allowed me to see the issue we need to deal with in the state house, which is taking the law more seriously. We need to have representatives that are actually reading the bills, analyzing them, taking the information back to their constituents. And my experience in the courtroom, in the legislative process, actually working to let people know about bills like the Redevelopment Powers Law, like expansions of search warrant bills, my experience is going to allow me to hit the ground running from day one for House District 80. Next, we've got ethics. Ethics is such a crucial issue, especially as we're dealing with a House district that has, as I mentioned, three different cities in it. But there's a lot of conflicts of interest going on at a lot of different levels, and that is just death to any kind of good coming out of the legislative process. When you've got people who have financial incentives, personal financial incentives, professional financial incentives, also having lawmaking power, you're gonna run into some problems. I don't have those issues. You know, I'm a public defender. I fortunately, as I've mentioned before, my husband is kind enough to subsidize my political antics. I don't need to be bought off by these folks that end up doing a lot of that at the state house. So I'm in a position where I can just focus directly on what's most important for the people of Georgia. So there are gonna be some ethics challenges coming up in this race. Unfortunately, some of the other announced candidates do have some pretty serious ones on their record with Brookhaven. And I think it's absolutely critical that we have people, again, who take the law seriously. You've got other people's lives in your hands. You've got all of our futures for the whole state of Georgia, as well as the impact that we have on the rest of the state. You've got to take it seriously, and that means avoiding conflicts of interest. They're just going to create the appearance of impropriety. And I really think the attitude that has been expressed by a number of our legislators, the way that I heard it was, you can't have the best people if you aren't willing to accept a few conflicts of interest. And besides, Georgia law says it's not a conflict of interest. So setting aside that those two explanations conflict with each other, I think we've developed a real comfort with the same person being an elected representative and a campaign consultant and a lobbyist. We need to separate those roles out. I want to be a state representative. My role would be representing the constituents here, not any outside lobbying interests, not any outside groups, but the concerns of people here. The last one I've got is effectiveness. And I think I'm going to be effective from day one, not just because of the experience, but because I understand the state legislature. We have a lot of folks who head up there with the best of intentions. They're going up, they're going to make a difference. Well, I've been involved in politics pretty heavily for the past 3 years, and it's not that easy. You know, that's how these really good, well-motivated people end up going up to the state house and ending up just like the rest of them. They're not prepared for the onslaught of lobbying cash. They're not prepared for the fact that lobbyists are often the only ones providing you with information about bills because your constituents haven't heard about the bills. They've got, you know, 600 bills coming out of the state house in 1 3-month legislative session. People aren't getting the chance to read them. And I don't think a lot of folks who go up there are ready for that challenge. I am ready for that challenge. I've studied law my whole life and with a concentration on government and legislation. I've analyzed legislation and I'm ready to do it for House District 80 in the same way I did with the Redevelopment Powers Law. For those of you that I haven't talked about that with yet, that was the referendum we had over in Brookhaven last fall, and it really crystallizes for me why I'm going to be an effective state rep for House District 80. Because what it involved was finding out that they were trying to put this bill on, that they were trying to put it on our ballot, which they didn't want anyone to know about in advance. So you've got to know the right channels to find out the information. Then you've got to be able to look at the bill and say, hey, you know, in this one subparagraph B on page 29, that actually is going to remove the constitutional restriction on debt and make it so the city council can now vote all of the citizens of Brookhaven into debt without even asking us first. There's a reason the Georgia Constitution prohibits that. So you've got to be able to find out that the bill is happening. You've got to be able to find out what's happening in the bill. And then you've got to be able to get the message out to the folks in the district. And that's why I'm going to be doing things like town halls, email updates, explaining every vote. I mean, that to me is a no-brainer. We've got a couple of folks up in the state legislature right now who are making a real solid effort on that. Our friend John Piesold is one of those who's doing that over in Harris County. And I just don't see any reason why everyone shouldn't be doing that. Yes, it's hard to have to write out your reason on a vote, but if you don't have a good reason for voting for a bill, then maybe you don't have time to be deciding that that's a bill that should be binding everyone in Georgia forevermore. So it's my experience, you know, as a lawyer, which we've got 4 lawyers in the race, it looks like, so you've got plenty of us to choose from. But I think it's important that we choose the one who actually has experience with the way that laws are being made and with the way that they're being interpreted in the courtrooms, because that's just not happening. So I'm happy to answer any questions about any specific issues, but I just wanted to thank everybody for coming out and let you know I do need your help and support. We've got 6 weeks left. I was down at the Capitol today qualifying, so I'm officially on the ballot, Catherine S. Bernard. So maybe if Taylor Bennett doesn't qualify, I'll be the first one on the ballot. But otherwise, Bennett comes before Bernard. Very unfair. So I'm all qualified. We've got 6 weeks until the election on July 14th. And honestly, people not knowing about the election is going to be one of our biggest obstacles. So it's something that we've got our door-to-door canvassers letting people know about. We're making phone calls. We're going to be sending out mailers. But we need your help. For those of you who live here in House District 80, obviously we need your vote, and we need all of our neighbors' votes as well. And even for those of us who don't live in House District 80, I see some friends from other parts of Fulton, from other parts of the metro area, and even outside. There's still a lot we can do. Everybody knows somebody in Brookhaven or Sandy Springs or Chamblee. So please take a moment, reach out to those folks, remind them you've got a special election coming up on July 14th. And this is the person who's going to be making decisions that are going to govern us for at least the next year. We need someone who's going to take the law seriously, and that's what I do. I see the way it impacts Georgia families every single day, and I am dedicated to making sure that it impacts them all in the most positive way possible. Got a philosophy of limited government, personal responsibility, adherence to the Constitution. I think that's something that pretty much all of us in House District 80 feel the same way. It's not really about parties. It's about the idea of the role we want government to play in our lives. And that role is taking care of business and otherwise getting out of our way so that we are free to enjoy beautiful Sandy Springs, Brookhaven, and Chamblee. So I'm asking for your vote on July 14th. I'm asking for your help to get me there, and I'm happy to take any questions. Well, when it comes to transportation, that's always the bugaboo, and it doesn't look like they came out with the best bill. Is there a way to kind of, is that just too hard to do, to nail it down and get, you know, broader solutions for transportation? Because we're all in gridlock in Metro Atlanta.
Well, I mean, it's going to be hard, but I certainly think that's no reason to not tackle it. You know, I live right by the Brookhaven MARTA station, which they are, you know, trying to redevelop. And I agree, you know, it's a big parking lot right now. It's not the highest and best use of the area. But the most important thing about transportation, I think, links back to economic development, which is what we were talking about. We've got a lot of people saying, oh, you've got to spend money to get rid of gridlock. But is it actually going to get rid of gridlock? Right. And that's, I think, the question with HB 170. You know, we were at the Atlanta Young Republicans a couple weeks ago with David Ralston, Speaker of the House, and actually Coleman asked a very good question of when he was talking about the transportation bill. So how do we actually know that it's going to help transportation in Georgia? And it was funny because you would think, like, no one had thought to ask this question before to the Speaker of the House. And his answer, it was, well, now the General Assembly has more oversight instead of GDOT. I found it a little inadequate, to be perfectly honest. So I think we've got to take on transportation again. And it's really critical that we get someone strong in the House District 80 spot, because as you know, Mike Jacobs was chairman of MARTA Oversight Committee. So we've got, he's been very powerful in there for 11 years. So it's really important that we get someone in there who has connections, not just with the metro area, but from the rest of the state. You know, I was a public defender in Lawrence County, know folks throughout the state very well through the GOP. My friend Dale, chairman of the 3rd District GOP, is here. So I think it's, you know, the metro area can feel a little isolated when you get into the legislature. It kind of feels like the rural folks outnumber them, but we really have a lot of the same interests, and I am ready to work on those interests for a good transportation bill instead of letting HB 170 continue, because I don't think it's going to do what they say it's going to do.
Thank you.
Awesome. Well, I'm so glad I covered everyone's concerns so thoroughly, and we can all get back to enjoying the beautiful
Well,
that we have.
Can do you mind saying a few words?
I would like to.
Okay.
Hi, my name's Garland Favorita. I just wanted to take a minute to talk with you. I've only known Catherine for 6 months, and we've been working in the legislature together for the last 6 months, and I told her I wanted to come and speak to you just for a minute. I'm not involved in her campaign, but she just absolutely blew me away in this last session. She read more bills than any legislator in the entire Georgia House. I honestly believe that. She analyzed the bills. She fed us information about these bills. And we had some really bad bills in the last session. I think you're all familiar with. I won't go into all the details because I could go on for an hour. But she, because of her, we got all of the word out to the public, and we could stop a lot of these bills. I testified with her on several committee hearings. It is fascinating to watch these legislators' face when she walks into a hearing room. They are petrified because they know that she is so articulate and she understands the issues. She has a lot of integrity and her motive is pure. She just wants to do the right thing for the people of Georgia. You don't run across that any and every day anymore. So, Catherine, I really, really admire you. And I want to do the best I can to help you out in this race. I'm asking everybody else to do the best that they can. This is a complicated race. You've got a Democrat and two Republicans, and a Republican district is going to be a split vote. Anybody could win. Catherine's very popular in this district. She has a great chance to win. But it's going to take probably about $50,000 for her to win this seat. Unfortunately, because of the campaign financing, money is buying seats in the Georgia State House. And I don't know if y'all are familiar, but there's a whole legislative House leadership scheme which funds candidates that they would like to get elected who will be establishment candidates. We don't need another establishment candidate in the Georgia State Legislature. We need someone who represents the people of Georgia and the people of Brookhaven, Sandy Springs, and all of this entire area. So it's kind of a difficult race. The Democrat has some curb appeal. The Republican has establishment connections. He will get a lot of capital cronyism contributions. We're up against a lot of money. But Catherine's popular enough to take this seat. But she's going to need a lot of help. She's going to need a lot of money. She's going to need a lot of volunteerism. So I've already gone in big, and I'm trying to get some more contributions for her. I'm going to ask everybody else, please do everything you can. Please give the most amount of money you can possibly afford to give, because I really think that Catherine will hold the legislature accountable, and she will be the best thing that's happened to the Georgia State Legislature in a long, long time. So thank you, Catherine, for everything.
Thank you so much.
Well, I'm so glad that you were able to come out and talk to folks, and it beats knocking on doors, which is what we did the first campaign.
So. Well, we're going to be doing plenty of that over the next 6 weeks. There are going to be lots of door knocking, and in fact, we have some folks out door knocking tonight.
Wonderful.
So wanted to make sure we're hitting all the doors. So thank you so much to everyone, especially to Tochie and Robert for hosting us tonight. And yeah, we accept all manner of donations on the website. There's a lovely little donate button so we can get those mailers out that we need to. And, you know, trying to be an accountable steward of people's money from the start. So thanks. I'm always accessible. We've got cards with my number, address, website, all that good stuff. And if anybody has anything they want to share. I mean, I'm trying to collapse the difference between campaigning and governing a little bit, because you get to the point where David Ralston says, we never could have passed this during an election year. I don't think they should be able to say that about any piece of legislation. Yeah. So if you don't think that either, please donate and help me get to the State House. Thanks.
Thanks.
Follow Catherine Bernard at Catherine for Georgia on Twitter. Catherine, the number 4, Georgia GA, on Twitter.
I've got it.
We're going to put you in the center, though. You're the candidate.
Right, Nydia, are you going to put this on the World Wide Web?
I'm going to shoot this way.
Nydia, come get your picture.
I'm going to shoot that way. Come here. So Catherine, Nydia. You can be in the middle there.
Yeah, Catherine.
Just watch your step. I'll sit back in the picture.
No, let's not.
Nydia, don't step back.
It wouldn't be the first
time.
I was.
Tell us where you
want to go. Between these two, we're so perfect.
Yeah.
It would be pretty awesome to get Nydia in here, too.
Move your finger out of the room.
I'm not
going to
push you in here.
I'll
never be welcome. Would you come in here?
Y'all need to get us close together if you can.
Close together.
Close together. Squeeze in. Way in.
Should I take my shoes off so I don't look so...
It doesn't matter.
Well, no.
Because I'm just going to do a headshot here.
I've done a few shots. I've been imperative already.
If I get 9 out of 10 eyes open, we'll
be competitive.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
But we do.
I'm proud to be in a picture with you.
Here we are.
I mean, I'll
go across so we can see.
Oh my gosh, that's a good picture. Thanks so much.
That is awesome.
A lot of powerful, strong women. Gotta love that.